Hello and welcome everyone. In this video, we are going to discuss about Matthew Arnold and one of his most important poems, Dover Beach. Now, Matthew Arnold, as we all know, was a British poet of the 19th century, the Victorian era, and he was born in a village named as Laleham near Thames, the River Thames. In all his work, Matthew Arnold has had a very interesting relationship with religion, especially for living during the Victorian era. And he was raised in a very liberal Anglican household, yet he was influenced by one very important figure, religious figure, John Henry Newman, who was also an important personality of church at the time. And he respected Newman for being a conservative Catholic, for his spirituality, for his love for religion. And Arnold became an agnostic later in life. Agnostic, what agnostic means? Agnostic ka matlab hota hai ek aisa insaan jo sure na ho ki whether Bhagwan exists karte hain ya nahi, God exists karte hain ya nahi, there is an idea like God or not. So his belief regarding religion was a bit different in the later stages of his life. But he also had a deep love for religion, and his renewed arguments for religious faith and adoption of classical and aesthetic morals were mainstream in Victorian thought of the times. Jo bhi Victorian era mein socha jata tha ki renewed religious faith ho aur fir se Christianity ko establish kiya jaye, uske morals ko establish kiya jaye everyday life mein. वो ये सपोर्ट करते थे. ही सपोर्टेड द मूवमेंट्स फॉर स्पिरिचुअलिटी एंड ही हैड सम वॉट अ लिटिल बिट डिफिकल्टी इन बिलीविंग इन दोज मूवमेंट्स, बट ही नेवरदलेस सपोर्टेड देम. एंड इन्होंने उसको अपने प्रोज वर्क में भी एक्सप्लोर किया है, पोइट्री में भी एक्सप्लोर किया है, जिसमें से डवर बीच एक बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट एग्जाम्पल है. नाउ डवर बीच में वो क्या बात कर रहे हैं, जो स्पीकर है, द स्पीकर लुक्स आउट अपॉन अ काम सी and observes the fullness of the tide and the moon reflecting on the water. Looking across the English Channel, the speaker sees the lights of the French coast fade away, while the cliffs of the English coast stand tall and bright and the bay seems calm. So that is what he is basically having in the first stanza, where he talks, the sea is calm tonight, the tide is full, the moon lies fair upon the straits. What are straits? Straits are is a narrow passage of water connecting two seas or two water bodies, large areas of water. So upon the straits there is light, moonlight, and on the French coast the light gleams and is gone. So there is light shining on the French coast and it goes, and the cliffs of England are standing tall and they are glimmering in the light out in the peaceful, tranquil means peaceful, bay. So the entire scene is very it has a very tranquil atmosphere, it is very peaceful. So now again, he is talking to someone else. He addresses this person and asks them to come to the window and look at what he is looking at and to enjoy the night's pleasant air. The speaker senses that something is not quite right in the external environment and describes the area where the water meets the moonlit land. The speaker instructs this other person to listen to the sound of the pebbles as the waves shift them back and forth and up the beach and down again. So the speaker notes this slow repeating action and then likens it or identifies it with the eternal sadness of nature. Begins and cease and then again begin with tremulous cadence slow and bring the eternal note of sadness in. So cadence is a modulation or inflection of the voice. It is a change in the rhythm of the voice. And that is what happens. He finds that the external environment has a note of sadness. Then the timeline changes. All of a sudden, the speaker thinks about the ancient Greek playwright Sophocles and imagines that Sophocles too has heard the same sadness in the Aegean Sea, A-E-G-E-A-N, as this particular speaker hears now on the English coast, on the coast of the English Channel. So Sophocles, in the mind of the speaker, likens the sad sound of the waves to the general sorrow of humanity, which moves like the waves. So the speaker then notices another thought that comes with the sound of the sea. He says, Sophocles long ago heard it on the Aegean, and it brought into his mind the turbid ebb and flow of human misery. So now this is again, the misery of human beings remains the same. Now what this misery is all about, we do not know right now. We find also in the sound a thought, hearing it by the distant northern sea. So now there is another kind of thought. And what is this thought? He goes on to explain in the next stanza. He says, the sea of faith was once too at the full and round earth shore, lay like the folds of a bright girdle furl. But now I only hear its melancholy long withdrawing roar, retreating to the breath of the night wind down the vast edges drear and naked shingles of the world. So now again he talks about the sea of faith. So this is the central idea of this particular poem. And this is the basic Victorian thought that has been expressed in this poem. That the central idea is a crisis of faith in the poem. Ek tarah ki crisis hai is particular poem mein, where the established Christian religion is facing challenge from the new scientific discoveries of the time. So there is a difficulty here. The poem is a powerful expression of alienation, doubt and melancholy, and foreshadows the existential crisis of the 20th century human beings. So basically it is about what it means to be living a life bereft of or life without spirituality, and what it means for human beings to be a part of the overall natural world around. So now he compares religious faith to a sea that was once full like the tide. At that time, it reached around the earth like a girdle. Now, girdle is a belt or a cord that is worn by a person around their waist. Waist pe pehna jata girdle. So, religious faith bhi usi tarah pura world ko cover karta tha ek particular point pe. It, religion was such a strong force at one particular point in history. That is what he means to say. Now, though the speaker hears and knows that there is some sort of spirituality still left in the world, but it is a retreating sound. It is the sea's sad retreat. As the sea of faith becomes smaller and smaller, it disappears into the atmosphere and leaves the edges of the world naked. So now religion is fading. Christianity is losing its power. Christianity again is a symbol for any religion or any religious faith. It does not simply mean ki isme sirf Christianity ki hi baat ki hai. Obviously he has talked about the Christian faith, but it can be implied to other faiths as well, because religion is antithetical or incompatible to scientific discoveries or science, and that is why religious faith is losing ground all over the world. That is what he says. And now in the final stanza he talks to this person, the listener whom he was earlier talking to, as and referred to this person as love. Ah, love, let us be true to one another, for the world which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither joy, nor love, nor light, nor certitude, nor peace, nor health for pain. All these things are not there in the world. And we are here as on a darkling plain. We are on a dark, secluded, lonely plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and flight. Armies are fighting and they don't know what they are actually fighting for. Is this fight even worth it? Where ignorant armies clash by night. So this is a very important, significant line from this poem. He states that these two people, he and the other listener, need his beloved, need them to treat each other with honesty and authenticity, because otherwise, apart from them, there is no authenticity in the external world. Because the world, though it has a dreamlike quality of variety, beauty, newness, doesn't actually offer joy, love or clarity. It looks very beautiful. It looks that human beings are making progress. But because religious faith is losing ground, because spirituality is losing, the particular speaker feels that there is no real joy in the external world. Neither claims the speaker that this world, this external world, can provide certainty or peace or relief from pain. So then he compares their collective situation to standing on a flat, dark plain, and then they are caught up in the chaos of fighting, in the clamor of the battlefield. And the battles are between unknowing groups who don't know why they are actually fighting for, but they are fighting an unjust war. So this poem talks about man's relationship with the natural world. It talks about loss of faith and certainty. That is the central theme of the poem. It was written during the Victorian era and laments the loss of religious faith that came with the advances in various fields at the time, such as evolutionary biology, geology, archaeology, and textual analysis of the Bible. The poem senses the turn of a historical era and finds this change is echoed in the figure of the beach and all the surrounding areas, the blurry border between land and sea. So the poem asks the reader to consider what is lost in the humanity's movement from Christian faith to a world of scientific discovery. So for the speaker, loss of faith is equal to loss of certainty. He equates both of them. He claims that even though the external world looks very beautiful, even though it has a rhythm, but that rhythm is that of sadness. It is an eternal note of sadness. And then this sadness suddenly brings the real agenda of the poet to the forefront. That is the loss of religious faith. And this loss has been happening over the ages. Sophocles, the Greek playwright, has also heard the same sadness in the sea that this particular speaker is hearing, and the people in the coming generation will see it further intensifying. So the speaker's position on this loss of religious faith is basically cleared by the third stanza, when he claims that this is a very sad state, and it is happening all over the world. It is a global state, because again, scientific discoveries are progressing all over the world, and especially in those times when the Victorian times was shifting to a modern era. So overall, the poem expresses a kind of resignation. The speaker is not seeing much hope for faith to be rekindled, but he wants to be true to this particular person. He wants to be true to one another, so that even though there are pessimistic times ahead, even though people are fighting, armies are fighting, but again, they can be authentic to one another and they can be true to each other, so that they have a real world of their beauty within their reach, as it so happens. So it is again, it changes the relationship of man to nature than that of the romantic poets who came before the Victorian period. The romantic poets found happiness or sublimity in the natural environment, whereas this particular speaker finds a deep sense of sorrow or sadness, even while he admits that there is a kind of beauty, a tranquil beauty in this scene as well. So the cold indifference and the vast power of the natural world make the speaker seem and like an alien in the surroundings. He feels small and insignificant in the surrounding, and therefore he tries to capture the complexity of the human experience as just one part of the natural world rather than as its center. So the human being no more remains the center of the universe or the center of the natural world as at many times in history he has been viewed to be. Then his going to Sophocles and the eras that have passed by again indicates that there is a sort of time scale that human lives have followed, and human beings are insignificant in terms of the time scale of the earth, the external world, the natural environment. And again, the beach and the sea are the most prominent figures in this particular poem. They are the central figures in the poem, and they are basically,
so the
this
rise
is the
of scientific development
runs the entire
become more
poem,
and more critical of
and
religious
human beings
being,
are just
and this becomes a cause
of
melancholy
or sadness for the speaker. The entire scenario seems dismal to the speaker, and he claims that there is a struggle and conflict everywhere in the world as a result of scientific inventions of advanced weapons of war and the ignorant armies who are just fighting battles without even realizing what it does to them. So this is the entire scenario. This is what science has given to the human beings. That is what the speaker seems to be claiming in this particular poem. This poem again is a dramatic monologue, which is a type of poem in which a single person who is not the poet but a speaker utters the entire poem in one specific situation at a critical moment, and this person addresses and interacts with another person, another listener. But we do not know of this listener's presence. and what they have said before or what they are about to say next. And this can only be discussed from the clues in the discourse of this particular speaker. And the principle that controls the poet's selection and organization of what this speaker is saying is the speaker's unintentional revelation or unintentional expression of his temperament and character. So this is what a dramatic monologue is, and by virtue of this, these descriptions which M.H. Abrams has given, this particular poem is also a dramatic monologue. So Dover Beach is a dramatic monologue because the speaker is addressing a listener who is part of the scene but does not answer back. He calls on this person in the first stanza, "Come to the window, sweet is the night air," and again later he says, "Love, let us be true to one another." But the other than this, there is no description of what this other person is like or how they have expressed themselves on this particular issue. So according to the basic features of a dramatic monologue, the poem is a dramatic monologue. It is uttered by a specific speaker in a single situation. Also, the listener is only talked about only through this particular speaker in a passing reference. But he does not speak anywhere in between. And finally, the speaker is revealing his innermost thoughts in an unintentional way in the form of a long continued narrative. So this is a dramatic monologue that laments the loss of true Christian faith in England during the 1800s and the growth of science that began to attract people towards itself. It consists of 37 lines and is divided into four unequal stanzas. There is irregular iambic pentameter used in the poem, and enjambment, which is a poetic device, has been used throughout the poem, wherein a clause or a sentence is continued from one line to the next with a break at the end of one line, and this is done throughout this poem. The poem is basically a pessimistic view of the world if it is asked, and the people are engaged in meaningless conflicts and wars for reasons they don't even understand, and religious faith that held them together in earlier times is now fading. So there is chaos everywhere and the speaker is sorrowful. Arnold's poetry again shows these themes of isolation and dwindling of religious faith, but he was also contradictory about his beliefs regarding religion, because at one point he felt that religious faith or spirituality is a necessary force in society, but also later on he went on to become an agnostic, someone who does not believe in God or religion or religious faith or the existence of God, and he really became an agnostic later on and advocated for reason, logic and science. So that is what this poem is all about. Thank you.